Welcome back. In this video, I'll be taking you through the considerations to organize a financing package. Let us start with the context. In the previous video, we went through the considerations that an investor makes, namely the decision whether he is going forward with a proposed investment or not. We saw that the expected return needs to be above certain thresholds. We call this consideration the investment decision. After the investor has decided that he is going to invest, he will need to organize the financing to make that investment happen. This brings the investor to another consideration, namely, what sources is he going to attract to finance that investment? This is referred to as the financing decision. This decision generally comes after the investment decision. In broad terms, the investor has two types of financing he can attract: debt and equity. In the financing decision, we decide on the mixture of these two components. So, how much debt and how much equity should we raise? We call this the capital structure. First, let us have a look at what the difference is between both financing types. Debt is the noun for borrowing. You borrow money to fund a part of your investment. For this, you need to sign a loan agreement, which provides that the lender, we also call him a financier, gives you money to invest. This occurs under the condition that you return that money to him, after an agreed term. This means that you now have a repayment obligation. Also, you will be expected to pay the lender a return for using his money. That return is called interest, and it is generally charged at a pre-agreed rate. The interest rate is set according to the risk that the lender perceives in the project, and so it is not based on the expected investment return. So there are two key terms that you need to remember for debt. You have a repayment obligation and a fixed funding cost. Equity usually gives ownership of the investment, and it is the risk-taking part of the funding. In a company, equity is usually issued as share capital. Unlike debt, you do not have a repayment obligation to the equity investor. On top of that, you do not have normally agree a fixed return. Instead, as a co-owner of the investment, the equity investor will be entitled to the full returns that the project generates, minus the interest that is paid to the lenders and minus the repayment obligation to the lenders. Both the interest and the repayment obligation have priority over the equity returns. If it so happens that an investment generates losses, the equity investor must bear these losses entirely, not the lender. This is because the lender wants his entire loan back, and because he receives priority in regaining losses over the equity investor. So there are two key terms to remember for equity. Firstly, if you raise equity, you do not have to pay it back. And secondly, the equity investor is prepared to bear the investment risks. A loan is less risky for the lender than equity is for the investor. This is because the repayment obligation in a loan, the priority to funds and the agreed interest rate. For this reason, a lender is usually satisfied with a lower interest rate than an equity investor. A lender may be happy with a return of 6%, when an equity investor may expect 10%. Therefore, equity is more expensive than debt, because having more equity increases your overall funding cost. The return that the equity investor can expect is essentially the investment IRR, minus the interest paid to the lenders. Let us look at an example. We have an investment of $1,000 that is expected to generate an annual return of 10% or $100 per year. Now let us imagine that we fund this investment with the following mix of debt and equity: 60% for debt, so we borrow $600, and 40% for equity, amounting to $400. The debt costs us 6% interest per year. To keep it simple, we are going to ignore the effect of taxes, because these can bring an extra layer of complexity. We need to pay 6% interest on our loan of $600, and that amounts to $36. The lender has priority on that cash flow. After he receives this cash flow, the lender is satisfied. So then the equity investor is entitled to the remainder, being $100 minus $36 is $64. In first instance, this seems quite a good return for the equity investor. $64 on an equity investment of $400. That is 16%. But hang on, the investment generated a return of only 10%. So how can the equity return suddenly be 16%? The reason for this is that a large proportion of the funding came from lenders who accepted 66% interest. That leaves an extra 4% for the equity investor. This boosts their return. We call this leverage, or in other words, gearing. This is only true if the project returns are higher than the interest rate. This holds for the example we used here. If we look at the situation where the project returns are only 2%, which is $20, then we have to conclude that this is not even enough to cover the loan interest of $36. This is because the lenders have priority to the cash flows. Therefore, the equity investors will need to supplement that from their equity capital, and this eats up their equity. What happens here is that the leverage effect now works against the equity investor, whereas before it acted in favor of the equity investor. So we have seen here that the borrowing reduces our funding cost. We have also seen that there is an interplay between borrowing and risk. We will probably need to borrow because our project most likely cannot bear the full cost of more expensive equity. And despite this necessity, we do not want to borrow too much. This is because a high loan brings risks if the investment returns decrease. So the challenge is to determine what level of debt will be sustainable. Let us look at how we determine that. The first factor we look at is the expected cash flow that is available for debt service in each year. We refer to this as CADS. This CADS must in all circumstances remain above the second factor. And the second factor consists of the cash flows that are necessary to the debt service. Here, the debt service is the interest and the contractual loan repayments. We call the ratio between both factors the debt service cover ratio, or DSCR. This ratio must always remain above one. Otherwise, the investor runs the risk of a default and financial difficulty. In practice, lenders usually require the DSCR to be well above one to allow for a safety margin if unfortunate events should happen. The minimum DSCR could, for example, be 1.5. This allows a net cash flow to drop by 33% before the debt service comes under threat. Applying a DSCR limitation gives us a useful tool to determine how much we can safely borrow. Conversely, it can also help to determine how much equity we will need to raise to cover the risks. When we look at the financial model later on in this course, we'll see that the Excel model is a useful tool to calculate the DSCR and to analyze it in different scenarios. Thanks for listening and see you soon.